I'm sure most everyone watching this has started experimenting with code generation tools of one kind or another. Today, I'm going to take a closer look at a particularly interesting new product in this vein. It's an entire IDE for AI-based code generation called Kiro from AWS. Let's take a closer look at how it works. So what we have here is the base interface for Kiro, which I have opened in an empty directory. It's built atop of a fork of Visual Studio Code. So if you're familiar with VS Code, a lot of this should also be familiar, like the icons on the side here with all of their references. The big new change is the Kiro task, which all of this I'm going to go to in a little bit more detail later. But the main thing is you have here a prompt, which will allow you to type a set of suggestions, just a free associative idea or two about what you'd like to build. So here's what I'm going to type. A simple command line tool to check Python projects and verify their virtual environments are valid. Once we submit this, Kiro will start thinking. And as Kiro generates code and makes changes, it will also give you the ability to see what changes have been made along the way by way of a diff. So each time there's a new set of changes, you can see a new diff pop up. It's actually kind of interesting to watch the code evolve as it goes through each particular phase of its development. It may take some time to think, even for a relatively simple project like this. So if I minimize this, or I switched away and started to do something else, Kiro would ping me in the taskbar after it's ready for my input and say, hey, I've finished doing whatever it is you asked me to do. Let's pick up where we left off. So you don't have to babysit absolutely every second that it's doing something. I'm just sitting with it for now as a way of demonstrating its behavior close up. So now it gives me a report about what it's created, what kind of features we have for this project. There's also a requirements.txt that it's generated for it. There is no external dependencies, which is nice. I didn't ask for any to be used. So if I run this, you'll notice that, by the way, when it asks us to do something, it will give us a command prompt. It will wait for our input. We could trust it and have it run on autopilot if we wanted to, or we could modify the command. For instance, if we wanted to use Py instead of Python, just for the sake of precision, I click accept command, and then it will run the command in question and check the output, make sure everything's valid. We'll then try to test it on the current directory. I'm going to try running it just with Python to see what happens. Let's see if it can recover from that. And now it tries Python 3. It doesn't get that either because that's not how I have Python set up on this system. Now it's falling back to using the py command, which is pretty much what I wanted it to do in the first place. And then gives us this detailed feedback. And since there's no virtual environment in this current directory, obviously it's reporting nothing. And it also has the ability to generate a JSON report. I didn't ask for that either, but it's nice to have it as a bonus, I suppose. So now it generates a report based on everything that it's done with commands about how to use it. I clicked accept all. I can look at the differences by way of the diff tool. So now I'm going to try this on a couple of projects that I have in the real world to see if their environments are tested as valid. And this one checks out. Let's try another one earlier. And that one is not working, and I know that for a fact. What I'd like to do, though, is have this recurse through a whole tree of projects and verify that they're all valid. So I'm going to say modify this project to check a whole directory of projects recursively. Kiro will now work. I'm going to cut ahead to after it's made all the changes. So now it's finished applying all of the changes and it's ready to perform a test. Let's see what happens. It now gives us a new R option to perform recursive scanning, along with some max depth and max workers options, which is nice. So what I could do is modify this to actually test in a directory where we have files that are stored in a tree so that it gives us some actual recursive output. And it gives us the output as it goes along, which is nice. I didn't specifically ask for that, but it's something I actually did want. As you can see, I have a lot of projects in here that are kind of broken. And unfortunately, one of the things that you are probably going to experience if you start trying out Kiro sooner rather than later is these errors. The model you've selected is experiencing a high volume of traffic. So I had this problem quite a bit when I was first working with Kiro until they raised the capacity for the backend a bit. So if it crashes like this, you can select a model that you want to retry with. You cross your fingers, maybe wait a few minutes before trying to make sure you're not hammering the server. But it does seem to be working correctly, just on the face of it. And this is, by the way, only a very small fraction of the total functionality that I've been playing with. Like, I haven't even talked about the steering documents yet. That's probably worth its own whole separate discussion. But this should give you a basic idea of what is available in Kiro just out of the box and without a whole lot of work on your part. Now, I recommend approaching anything that comes out of one of these code generation tools with extreme skepticism. I wouldn't put any of this code directly into production without having a chance to test it myself, and I wouldn't necessarily trust any of the generated tests that are produced by Kiro either. I'd want to look at them and, if possible, produce my own test suite. That said, I'm very curious to see where this goes next. And that's it for this episode. If you liked it, leave a comment below, and don't forget to follow Dev with Serdar on Facebook, YouTube, and Infoworld.com.